to do topic modeling. So before I get started, this talk will be in English because I cannot speak much French. Please, if I'm going too fast or too slow, or if you cannot understand what I'm saying, then please stop me so I can repeat myself. So what is GenSim? GenSim is an open source natural language processing Python library. Now, why GenSim is really popular for topic modeling or natural language processing is because it's, as you can see out here, it's memory independent. So if you're dealing with really, really big data, big textual data, or a lot of documents, then this is useful because you can stream your documents and it doesn't take up space in RAM. So these are some of the features of GenSim. And my favorite feature of GenSim is how easy it is to use. You just need Python installed and SciPy and NumPy, the machine learning or the numerical computing toolkits installed on your machines, and GenSim is very, very easy to use. A little bit about me. My name is Bhargav, and my association with GenSim is through the Google Summer of Code program. I'm currently working at Indria Lille as a research assistant, and where je parle un peu de français. So that's why this will be in English. You can find me on GitHub with Bhargav Vader. So moving to why you would want to use GenSim and why you would want to use topic modeling. Let's put ourselves in a situation, say we all work at a newspaper agency, maybe Le Monde, and we have lots and lots of textual data. So we don't have structured data, we just have lots and lots of text. We can have company documents, which is internal company documents. You can have newspaper articles, you can have, in this, you have lots of data. And sometimes it's tough to just use keyword matching or your standard search algorithms to manage this kind of data. So this is where topic modeling comes in. Now, if we have, say, our internal company documents, how does topic modeling help? Again, if you are working for a newspaper agency and you want to know how your the documents inside of your agency are organized, if you run a topic modeling algorithm on all of the internal company documents, you might come up with something like this, which says 40% is marketing, 5% is customer support, then you have legal documents, engineering. So what this does is, instead of looking for keywords, you look for topics or general topics. And how this also helps is it's not labeled. So you just have your documents and it does a clustering for you. So if you have some experience with machine learning or clustering, you'd know that it's putting similar items together. So what this does is it allows us to find topics, and we can put similar documents into similar topics. Out here, another motivation to use topic modeling is similar content. So for example, again, if you're working for a newspaper or a marketing company and you want to find out certain documents are more similar to other documents, you can use topics to break up and identify where a certain document should go. And of course, you can use this to find reading patterns for advertising purposes and just for managing a really, really large textual data set. Again, if you'd like to stop or ask me to explain something, then please feel free. Outside of just business needs, even if you're conducting research, I personally found it very interesting to analyze research documents if you're analyzing research papers or abstracts. For example, in this particular case, for math research papers in America, if you just run a topic modeling algorithm, you can find out that all the research papers are roughly distributed like this. So you can see that a lot of research maybe goes on in algebraic geometry, and certain research goes on in functional programming or functional mathematics. So it's a good way to understand what your documents are made of and what the words are and what kind of topics are there. So this is some of the motivation. So for myself, I find my biggest motivation is for social media, for understanding, say, Twitter trends or, you know, Facebook trends. You can model your topics together to find out what people are talking about. And if you are also interested in, for example, I worked on software engineering data sets to find out how many researchers are researching maybe object-oriented programming, or how many researchers are researching Python or using Python. So by picking up certain keywords and putting them into topics and seeing what kind of topics your documents fall into, it's a very useful machine learning toolkit. Now, getting into exactly what topic modeling is, as the name suggests, it's a generative model, which means that it generates topics. Topics are nothing but a collection of words. So topics are made out of words, and documents are made out of topics. So you can see out here that you have top documents. So initially we talked about Le Monde or the newspaper. So if we now move to a setting of newspaper articles, so we're all reading the newspaper, and you can say that each newspaper article is made out of certain topics, and each topic is made out of certain words. Now, this is very important to understand that what exactly topics, documents, and words are. So again, if you want some clarifications, please stop me. Let's go into a more particular example. Let's assume that we want three topics from our newspaper data set. So maybe the last 3 or 4 months of newspaper articles in English in this particular example. You can see that, say, if you look at a rough topic of politics, you have these kind of words. Here it's Trump, Clinton, conservative, or maybe American politics. You have one topic about the weather and one topic about sports. So out here, it's very important to understand that this is our final result. After we run our topic modeling algorithm on a data set of newspaper articles, this is the output we get. So we get the output that, user, these are the kind of topics you have present in your data set. So you basically tell your algorithm that you want three topics, and this is your data set, and this would be the output. Now, how do documents feature into this? You can roughly think of each document being created from topics. So in this particular case, you can say that this particular document, you can ignore the actual words, they're just not, I mean, random words, but you can say they're made of 50% of politics, 30% of weather, and 20% sports. So that's what your document looks like if you're going to make each document from topics. So out here, you can, for example, see the recipe. So if you look at document one, you can see the recipe of document one is a mixture of three topics. But the question is, how do we get these topics? I mean, that's what's important, because right now we just have documents and we have no information about these documents. But suddenly we know that this document is made out of these three topics. So how do we get this information? Bayesian inference, which is a probabilistic model where we sort of use an expectation maximization algorithm. For those with a background in statistics, you might know, but even for those who don't, it's not really important. What is important is to understand that we tell the algorithm that we want three topics. So it sort of runs through each document and figures out what kind of words are likely to be around other kinds of words. So you know that, for example, if you're talking about politics, certain words appear more common to do with politics. Certain words are more to do with weather and some to do with sports. So you can see if your documents are like this. For example, the last document is only about football. So it would be a pure football document. So you can see, again, this is a good way to understand what your documents are about without actually reading them or understanding them. A bit into the mathematical background, the most popular topic modeling algorithm used in Jensen is the latent Dirichlet allocation. And this is what you call a plate notation. So this is the mathematical notation for the algorithm which I was discussing. And out here, it's important to understand, I'm just going to briefly explain this. In this plate notation, the algorithm is called a latent Dirichlet allocation, because here latent means unknown to us. And what is unknown to us is topics. We don't know what the topics are. So out here, theta and zeta are our topic distributions, which are unknown to us. And alpha and beta are priors which we assume on those distributions. The only thing we know is W, which are the words in the document. What the key takeaway from this diagram is that the only thing we know is W, which are the words in the documents, and what we find out is theta and zeta. Here, theta is the document topic proportion, which basically means every single document, what is the breakup of the topics. So if you have a document about someone playing football in the rainy weather, you should know that it's 50% this, 50% this. This unknown topic is your theta. And zeta out here is each topic, what words are made out of it. For example, the topic of politics has Trump and Clinton and so on. That is zeta. So theta and zeta are unknown to us, and it's what we identify after running this algorithm. W is the only thing which we know, which are the words in the document. And alpha and beta are derelict priors, which we assume in the algorithm. In case anybody wants to write it down, whatever I've spoke, I've just written down here. But I would highly recommend reading this research paper, Latent Derelict Allocation. It's an incredibly interesting research paper written quite simply. So even those without a mathematical or computer science background can appreciate and understand this algorithm. But from our point of view, if we just leave the mathematics aside, what we can just go to is maybe how it's useful to us. So we just need some things to be known. So now I'm going to discuss about actually using this algorithm. We just need to know how many topics we want. So if we have our data set and we say I want 5 topics or 3 topics, we need to know this. These are some parameters which we can fix. Do we want our documents to have many topics or less topics? Do we want our topics to have a few words or many words? And these we don't need to set ourselves. GenSim is also capable enough to fix these on their own, but if we wish, we can set it ourselves. And these are more advanced things where we can, if we know that some topics exist, we can pre-seed topics, so we can get into the mathematical properties of it. But what's relevant to us is just this. So for example, if you are running the code, you just say your model is equal to an LDA model. Your corpus is your data set. So you just put in your data set and your number of topics. So that's all you need. You just need your data and the number of topics, and the algorithm does everything for you. Now I'm going to briefly talk about which topic model is the best. So there are two ways to do this, either manually or using another algorithm called topic coherence. So how do we manually evaluate it? If you look in this particular example from the research paper, the original research paper, this was an article, a newspaper article, and these were 4 topics which he came up with: arts, budget, children, education. So he just assigned a color to every topic, and you basically just color your document. So by coloring your document, you can understand what your document is made out of, what kind of topics is your document made out of. An easier example in this particular case, if you're talking about river banks or financial banks, if this is your sentence, bank, water, river, tree, and you want to find out if your model is a good model or a bad model, out here, if you color all water bank related words as blue and financial bank related words as red, you can see that the bank here is red. So for this particular document, the bad LDA has said that bank is to do with financial bank, but this is all a water bank. So this is a bad model because it's saying that this bank is a financial bank, but it's clearly a water bank. But if you see a good model, you can see that bank is indeed blue out here. So it's just an easy example to try and understand. By putting different colors to different topics, we can manually inspect documents and find out what they are. But of course, humans, the whole point of machine learning is to make humans avoid this whole point of actually manually evaluating. So this summer, there was a student project by Devashish, who is going to also be conducting a workshop on GenSim tomorrow. So I'd love it if you could all make it there. What we would do out here is you can just find the coherence of a model by a simple API. This is how the API looks like. We'll get more into the coding tomorrow at the workshop. But you can just find out what your topic is, if it's a good topic or a bad topic model, by just running a simple algorithm, which is all inbuilt by GenSim, of course. So I think we're going to be reaching the end of our talk. And my motivation behind this talk was to tell you that you can really, really easily understand your textual data with Python and GenSim. It's absurdly easy, And there are very easy ways to find out if there's a good way or a bad way to find out your topic model, either through coherence or through actually coloring your document. And what else can we do using GenSim, which is the library I'm talking about? You can do dynamic topic modeling, you can do vector space modeling, and there's other topic modeling algorithms. If you sat for the previous talks, maybe about neural networks or Theano and things like that, neural networks are the base of Doc2vec and Vert2vec, which are two algorithms by Google for vector space modeling. All of this is implemented in GenSim, and it's really fast algorithms, and like I said, it's memory independent. As for the next, what I would love, the audience to maybe explore for themselves is using GenSim and Rare Technologies, which is the parent company of GenSim. There we regularly hold sprints and tutorials. We had the last one in Bangalore in India, but there have been ones in Portland, Oregon. There have been one in UK, in Cardiff. So we have these tutorials all over the world, these sprints where we talk more about machine learning for natural language and text. And it would, well, as for what I would love to maybe happen, would see more people contributing to GenSim. It's an open source library, and we would really welcome issues and pull requests. And if GenSim could solve business problems in France, because again, since it's a machine learning algorithm, it doesn't matter if it's English. You can obviously do topic modeling for French documents as well, obviously. And that's pretty much it. And hopefully, so tomorrow at 3:45 in the afternoon, we'll be holding a workshop where we'll actually be going through a Twitter classification algorithm, where we'll try and explain how we actually use GenSim to classify social media and news and further machine learning to do with text processing. So this workshop is tomorrow at PyCon out here at 3:45. You can find the exact room in the schedule. But that's it. Thank you. Yes?
Yes. How do you measure the coherence of
How do you measure the coherence? This is there was a paper by I think a group in Germany which basically tried to identify human coherence. So your input will be texts, which is your textual data, which you're inputting. And the algorithm is actually implemented by, he's sitting in the audience right here. He's Devashish, and he'll be actually discussing it tomorrow. So I haven't worked on the algorithm behind topic coherence. So if you want, after the talk, you can talk to me or Devashish, and I can actually tell you the mathematical reasoning behind it. But the idea is human coherence, because the input is texts in the form of sentences. So, for example, if you feed many newspaper articles, it identifies what makes sense to a human, because certain words tend to be in certain sentences. So, looking based on the outputs of your topics, so for example, if one topic has nonsense words like was, is, been, has, it understands that this is not something which is human interpretable. So, by using the text, which is the original data, it identifies what topics are more likely to make sense to a human. But for the exact mathematical basis, you can talk to Devashish after this. He's in the audience, and I can introduce you to him. So that's the mathematical significance behind the algorithm. But what it works on is human coherence. So it tries to make the topics something which a human can best understand. But there are many topics, many topic coherence measures, which are implemented, which are based on probabilistic measures, like what are the odds of certain words being with certain words which make more sense than being with other words. Like Trump and football are likely not to be a good topic because they won't be in the same document as often or in the same text as often, but some things will be more often than the others. I know this sounds very hand-wavy and not very mathematical, but I can actually get into the details after this, after the talk. But also, I'll be putting up details of all the research, I mean the references, for example, the original algorithm, which is latent derelict allocation, and the topic coherence research paper. So you can read the paper yourself and have a really thorough understanding of. And also, I would like to mention that all of the code which was in the slide, not much code, but it's all available as GenSim tutorials written by students and developers over the last year. So everything I've talked about, we have a tutorial on the GenSim, the GitHub page. You can find IPython notebooks, which have both the mathematical intuition behind the algorithms and the actual business need for the algorithms. Yes? Yes. So we have online LDA as well, where you can update your LDA with a prior seed as well. You cannot add more topics. Because the internal matrices which actually store the data, the size of the matrices are fixed based on the number of topics. So increasing the number of topics would you would have to rerun the algorithm from all over again. But if you'd want to add more texts or words, then you can. So this was Devashish who had initially talked about. So I have worked with Devashish before with GenSim. So while the latent derelict allocation, which is the algorithm I talked about here, it doesn't have the ability to add new topics because the whole algorithm is built with the first input which you give is the number of topics. So all the data sets, the internal mathematics going on is based on the number of topics. So while you can increase your words and you can increase your documents, you cannot increase the number of topics. But what Devashish just said is that there's another algorithm which I talked about out here very briefly, which is HDP. It's called the hierarchical derelict process. It's another topic modeling algorithm. In this particular algorithm, you can update your documents and your topics. The LSI is latent semantic indexing, which is another such algorithm which allows you to find out topics. Can just note all of these down if you'd like. Yes? I can give you I don't know if this will answer your question, but this particular algorithm, LDA, was actually simultaneously developed for textual data and for biological data, for like DNA, for example, because it found that certain proteins were found in the proximity of other proteins. So people use topic modeling for videos and images and for DNA as well. What exactly was your question? Is it this? No, yes, well, it's optimized for textual data, yes. Natural language processing that's the prime domain of GenSim. But in the end, one thing I would like to say is that GenSim operates on a vectorized feature space. So in the end, all of your words become numbers. For example, if you have a huge dictionary, you can have like each word is a number. So these numbers is the input. So the algorithm doesn't understand words, obviously. It understands just binary numbers. So if you would want these words to instead be protein, or then you can do that. So how it's used for images, for example, every pixel. So instead of every word, you have pixels. So you can also use topic modeling on images. If your input data is every pixel, then you can identify that. You can give an image and you can say, oh, this image has these kind of pixels. So it's a maybe like a sad because it has lots of blue in it, and if it has red, like happy, you can sort of use topic modeling for images as well. Of course, I'd imagine while the algorithm remains the same, the easy API which GenSim uses is mainly for text. So the prime business problem which we're trying to solve is textual processing, but you can use it for other purposes as well. Any other questions? Yes? Yes, indeed. This is like many people say, like 80% or 90% of natural language processing is pre-processing. So if you're going to, this is another very famous saying, garbage in, garbage out. I mean, if you're going to just give lots of text which is not cleaned properly, then your topics will be like has, is, was is one topic. The other topic is going to be like random names. So what would be really what to optimize the results of your algorithm, you'd want to get rid of stop words. You'd want to stem your words. Now, stopping and stemming are certain things which we use in pre-processing for natural language processing. And now, these questions are really good for me because the tomorrow's workshop will be very useful because we'll be going through all the practical concerns of natural language processing. So while I've spoken to you more about why you would want to use GenSim, the actual getting down to doing it, you'll realize that a lot of the work is just organizing your data set and in organizing your textual data. So yes, you would have to pre-process. So some of the things would be to remove common words. If you know that a certain word is appearing in every document, then it's not going to be useful to have that word. So you can remove that particular word. And you'd maybe need to, for example, stop and stopping, you'd want to make it the same word because it means the same thing. So these are some pre-processing which we do in natural language processing, which would need to be done before applying it to an algorithm like this. Yes? Okay, yeah.
I have found some difficulties to find French and free and open French.
Yes, yes.
I don't know if you know good French courses to play with, but you have a lot of English.
Yes. Yeah, that certainly is a problem. I mean, being an Indian, I really face the problem because we can't. It's tough to use these algorithms for Indian languages as well. So it's especially for Word2Vec and Doc2Vec, which you have worked with. You would require a trained or pre-trained vectors in French. So I'm afraid I don't know of any French data sets right now. But in fact, it would be really useful for us to have, for example, French and German, Spanish, Italian, more languages which are better. But at least for the context of topic modeling here, you can use a French data set because this assumes nothing. Like I said, it's for completely unstructured data. You don't need to have any labels. So you just need to give in your textual data and you get your output. So while you would have had a problem for Word2Vec and Doc2Vec because it would maybe require a good a tagged data set in French, which you might not find, these algorithms require no tagging at all. So you can use a French data set and have just as good or maybe even better results in French. So these data are language independent. Yes? Yeah, so it would fit because again, like I said, every single word is a single number. So again, you have to understand that this does not assume anything about the language. It just assumes what words are appearing around other words. That it's fine. So I have not, I've seen a lot, like for example, on the GenSim mailing list, which I would want all of you guys to subscribe to, we have a lot of people sending in queries from both China, Japan and Korea. And all of them are using our topic modeling algorithms. So while it may be a bit more of a problem to use Word2Vec and Doc2Vec, which needs tagged data, because this requires no tagged data and it's unstructured data, it's fine for it to be any language. I think my time is up, so yes. Thank you, yes. Thank you.